July 4th, 1957. Former screen siren Gail Russell makes a smashing entrance, and not the glamorous red carpet kind. The actress whose dark beauty made grown men cry was back in the news for being back behind the wheel, intoxicated yet again. Maria Chacha is a film historian.
One of the most spectacular accidents that she had occurred when she drove her car into Jan's coffee shop. Fortunately, there was no one in the coffee shop except for a poor janitor who was pinned under the wheels of the car. He was injured, but he didn't die, and she was completely and totally devastated.
Writer and producer Andrew J. Fennedy.
I mean, she had a record. As I say, she was on police blotter after police blotter. She had drunken driving. She had smashed into the back end of somebody else's car. You know, it was well known around town that nobody would hire because they didn't know whether she would show up or whether she would show up drunk.
Russell was a star at 19, washed up at 26, and scandal sheet cover girl before age 30. The Hollywood rat race claimed another victim, but this one never bothered to put up a fight. Karen Burroughs Hansberry is the author of Femme Noir, Bad Girls of Film.
Gail Russell was born on September 21st, 1924, in Chicago, Illinois, the second child of Gladys and George Russell. She was a loner. She had few friends. If company would come to the house, she would run and hide. If she had to recite something in school, she was likely not to show up at all.
Author of Fallen Angels, Kurt Crivello.
After school, she would just go to her room, and she liked to paint and sketch. And she always thought that someday she would be a commercial artist.
Gail's father was an auto bond salesman, and he frequently moved his family from place to place. In 1936, the family moved to Glendale, California, and Gail was on her way to becoming a very promising art student in high school when a chance encounter changed her life forever.
In March of 1942, two of Gail's classmates at Santa Monica High School decided to skip class and hitchhike out of town. With a flick of their thumbs, the boys unwittingly set Gail on a collision course with doom. Johnny Grant is the honorary mayor of Hollywood.
Bill Michael John, who was the head of the talent department over at Paramount, gave a couple of young students a ride one day, and when they found out who he was, they said, "Well, you ought to see our version of Hedy Lamarr," and said, "You got to see our gal." And they were talking about Gail Russell.
One day, she reported to class, and there was a telegram on her desk that said that Milton Lewis, head of young talent at Paramount, wanted her to come in for an interview. The minute Milton Lewis saw her, he knew that Paramount would sign her. He saw those sad, blue sapphire eyes.
Studio execs recognized the potential gold mine they had in Gail and wasted no time screen testing the teenager. No one was more excited about the opportunity than Russell's mother.
Her mother had wanted to be an actress herself, and she was living vicariously through Gail. In fact, Gail said herself, "My mother dragged me there." So I think it was more her mother wanting to push her into it and Gail going along with it.
Gail tested a scene from The Postman Always Rings twice. In July of 1942, 2 months short of her 18th birthday, she was placed under contract to Paramount Studios.
Actress Ruth Warrick worked with Russell.
She really was the extraordinarily beautiful young girl who was taken out of high school and plumped into movies. She really did not like it at all. She was very, very shy, almost pathetically shy. And it was very, very hard for her.
Gail had no experience in acting whatsoever. She had never even seen a movie camera before. So the studio assigned a drama coach to work with her to help correct her posture and give her acting techniques.
But nothing prepared Gail for that first day of filming. Actor Jimmy Lydon co-starred with Russell in her big screen debut, Henry Aldrich Gets Glamour.
As we started to rehearse, even before we started the shoot, she couldn't get through a full rehearsal, and finally, after three or four attempts, she began to cry. Just broke down, and she cried and cried and cried, and so we babied her and cajoled her and finally got her back on the set, and they powdered her back up again, and we started the shoot, and she finally got through a take that was so-so.
Gail was off to a shaky start, but with some TLC from cast and crew, the rookie actress rose to the challenge and turned in a likable performance. Up next, Gail Russell battles ghosts and ghouls in a film that makes her a star, but finds comfort with spirits of a different kind. At the ripe old age of 17, actress Gail Russell had most of the makings of a Hollywood star: beauty, talent, and a 7-year contract at Paramount. The only thing Gail was missing? Confidence.
She was always terribly afraid of a camera. For some, you know, the camera was her best friend. The trouble is, she didn't know it, or she didn't realize it. And she, just the sight of a camera would send her scurrying away.
Gail had more than just butterflies in her stomach. The shy teenager would shake uncontrollably and lose her voice whenever she was asked to appear on a soundstage.
She was fragile. She had to be nourished, and Paramount Studios wasn't the most nourishing place in the world for a fragile little flower, you know? They wanted to get their money's worth and put them on the screen.
Despite Russell's fears, Paramount cast the reluctant actress in the 1944 picture, The Uninvited.
Oh, my God.
Stop it, Scott.
Shh, she's in a trance.
Gail Russell made an incredible impression in the film The Uninvited, which was a Hollywood ghost story, a classic, based on a well-known book. And she was the ingenue, Stella, for whom the song Stella by Starlight was written in the movie. She played opposite Ray Milland, and it really put her on top.
She got good notices for the part she played, which was kind of right down her alley, because she was supposed to be terrified, and she was. She was terrified of the whole process, not only the film.
She said the lights would go on and people would be talking to her and she couldn't hear them and she would just panic. It's always sounded to me as if she had anxiety attacks.
It was around the time of The Uninvited that Gail began to get her support from another source, and that was alcohol. Before long, she began drinking between scenes at a cafe across the street from the studio. And she also made sure that her dressing room was equipped with a bottle of vodka.
Gail wasn't the first actress in Hollywood with a penchant for the sauce, and the folks at Paramount knew just how to handle a problem.
The studio was very well aware that Gail was using alcohol as this crutch, as this confidence builder. And instead of trying to help her or trying to stop what was going on, they just hushed it up. They closed her sets to outsiders. They restricted her interviews with the press.
But a big screen career wasn't really Gail's cup of tea.
She really didn't want to be in the movies. She didn't want to do that. She really had no interest in it. And she didn't feel she had any ability. Well, she had a modicum amount of talent, but it was true she really was not an actress at heart.
Still, Russell managed to rise through the ranks to become a certifiable star. In 1945, the 21-year-old met and fell in love with a hunky 23-year-old actor named Guy Madison.
They were a very handsome couple. I mean, he was really one of the most handsome guys in the film business at that time, and her being the goddess.
But then the champagne turned into something called vodka, and she was out of step with the music and everything else.
Gail Russell always felt as if she did not have control of her own life, that circumstances swept her up and that she went from one job to another, and there was no time to really stop and take stock of what she was doing or what it was that she wanted to do.
Another Hollywood tragedy waiting to happen. When we come back, a near-fatal twist leaves Gail Russell shaken, the media stirred, and her career on the rocks. By 1947, screen beauty Gail Russell was hitting it big in Hollywood. Of course, the 23-year-old actress was also hitting the bottle hard. Russell needed a savior. She thought she found one in an older Hollywood hero.
She starred in Angel and the Bad Man with John Wayne, which is actually her best remembered film. During the filming of this movie, they became quite good friends. Some people say that they were more than friends, but others say that it was maybe more on Gail's part. She fell in love with John Wayne, but he just saw her as a young girl who needed some help and some support, and that's what he gave her.
Unfortunately, Wayne's jealous wife, Chadha, didn't take too kindly to her husband's charity case.
Chadha got wind of it, locked him out of the house after he and Gail had been to a rap party together.
Both Wayne and Russell denied there was any hanky-panky going on. And in July 1949, Gail married her true Prince Charming, Guy Madison, in Santa Barbara, California. But Gail's boozing put her marriage and her career in jeopardy. Longtime Paramount executive A.C. Lyles.
Gail Russell was a very big worry for all of us on the lot, particularly those of us who knew her and were fond of her, because we worried about her health.
Still, the worst was yet to come. In 1950, Paramount dropped Gail from their roster of contract players, and in 1953, Chata Wayne dragged Gail into the Duke's divorce trial.
She named Gail Russell as correspondent in the divorce case, and it drove Gail Russell into a sanitarium. She literally had a nervous breakdown.
Gail spent 1 month in a sanitarium in Seattle undergoing intensive psychotherapy treatments. What she really needed to do was dry out.
A few days after her release, she was involved in the first of a series of drunk driving accidents. In this first one, she was driving behind a police car, constantly honking her horn. And finally, they pulled her over, gave her a sobriety test, which she failed, and arrested her for drunk driving.
Russell was fined $150 and given 2 years probation. But the most damaging consequence of the arrest was the effect it had on Gail's marriage. Guy Madison could no longer tolerate his wife's constant drinking. The two split in December 1953 and were divorced the following year.
It got to the point where even Prince Charming couldn't look into those bleary blue eyes anymore.
She said when she got married, she didn't have time to work at it, and she didn't have time to appreciate it because she was working all the time. So one film after another.
Not to mention one arrest after another. In 1955, Gail skidded into the headlines once again.
Gail was driving and hit the car of Mr. Leonard Deutsch, his wife Betty, and their daughter, who had been named after Gail, Little Gail. She hit them and then she took off. Fortunately, no one was killed. But that was another very bad accident that got very bad publicity for her.
Her career, her life took a nosedive. She began to appear on more police blotters than movies. The only bright spot during the 50s was when John Wayne O'Duke gave her a part in Seven Men From Now. He wasn't in the picture, but his company produced it. But the Gail Russell in Seven Men From Now didn't look much like the angel and the bad man.
The film marked Gail's first screen appearance in 3 years, but the 33-year-old actress didn't need work. She needed help. On the 4th of July, 1957, Gail made an unexpected turn into a local LA coffee shop. The only problem here, this restaurant didn't have a drive-thru.
Gail's worst drunk driving arrest was when she drove her car through the glass window of a coffee house, pinning the night janitor underneath the wheels, and he suffered extensive hip and leg injuries. When she went before the judge, immediately following this incident, the judge asked her how much she had had to drink, and she told him that she didn't know, maybe 2 drinks, maybe 4, and then she told him it was nobody's business but her own. But she still was very contrite about the incident. She was very upset and very concerned for the young man that she hit, and she said she would give all her money if she could take it back.
Gail admitted that she was an alcoholic, but told the press that she succeeded in putting an end to her addiction.
Supposedly, she felt she licked her drinking problem. She did apparently say that she had licked it. She said that more than once.
The truth was that Gail Russell wanted to lick her drinking problem, but was powerless over the bottle. Coming up, Russell moves to the small screen in an attempt to revive her career, but it's last call for another lost Hollywood soul. By 1960, 36-year-old actress Gail Russell was no longer the toast of Hollywood. She was just plain toasted. The years of alcohol abuse robbed Russell of her looks, her marriage, and her career.
She didn't get very much work. She concentrated a lot on her artwork. She apparently, at that time, had just kind of settled into being a functioning alcoholic, and she did do an episode of Here's Hollywood, which was a, you know, TV interview show, and showed on that television show a lot of her artwork, and I think always claimed that she wasn't drinking.
But in reality, Gail was always drinking.
She used that as a crutch for her homework, and eventually, of course, it got her, because you can't constantly use something as a crutch like that and not have it get into your system and take over your life, which was sad, because she was a nice girl and a good girl. But you cannot fight alcohol if you're going to have it every day.
In the spring of 61, the shy actress was poised for a comeback when she appeared on the TV Western series The Rebel. Andrew J. Fennedy created the drama.
She muffed the first couple of takes, and she laughed, and everybody laughed. By take 9, nobody was laughing anymore. Tears were swimming in her eyes, and she said, "Oh, I'm sorry, Mr. Fennedy, it's taken so long, but I know I can do it." And I said, "Forget it. We're not going to shoot this scene." I didn't want her to go out and find some liquid companionship, you know. So I took a hold of her and walked her across the street. The waitress said to me, "AJ, you want a drink?" I said, no, real fast. She said, "Oh, that's all right, Andy. If you want to have a drink, don't worry. It won't bother me. I've won that battle."
My future hopes were whittled away.
And then she took a hold of my hand and squeezed it. And she said, "Andy, please, don't rewrite that scene. I know I can do it." I was a sunk duck. I said, "All right." She came down the stairs with lines, letter perfect, the first take, print. By the time we were finished, she was absolutely radiant.
But the glow faded quickly. Gail retreated into her own private world, alone with her vodka and memories. 17 years had passed since Russell hit it big in The Uninvited.
That song, Stella by Starlight, which was used in the film, and that was her all-time favorite piece of music. I was a disc jockey at the time, and I used to get calls from Gail asking me to play that. And she never wanted her name mentioned. She just wanted to hear the music.
Only days before she died, Gail phoned the radio station to hear that song one last time.
In 1961, just a month or so short of her 37th birthday, Gail was found dead on the floor of her Brentwood apartment. There was an empty vodka bottle beside her and several more scattered throughout the apartment. One of her neighbors said after her death that Gail had a sincere desire to stop drinking, but she just couldn't.
In her last years, she couldn't get work at all because nobody would take a chance. They couldn't get a film finished with her. And she finally died all alone. And there were certain rumors that she'd committed suicide. She didn't commit suicide at all. She died of malnutrition caused by alcoholism because she never ate anything. She just drank.
When Gail died, there were several versions of why she had died and what the cause of death was. I know what the cause of death was. It was called unhappiness. She had a strong chain of life, but there was one link, a weakness, and that tore her life apart.
The reporter came on and said that actress Gail Russell, age 36, was found dead in her apartment. An apartment cluttered with empty vodka bottles. I lit up a cigar and went outside for a walk. The song, Stella by Starlight, kept going through my mind. I looked up into the midnight sky and thought, yeah, the night has 1,000 eyes. That night it had 1,002.
Was Hollywood to blame? Was it the booze or a deadly combination of the two? I think Gail Russell would have been better off as a movie goer and not a movie star. I'm AJ Benza. Join me the next time we take a stroll down the flip side of the Hollywood Walk of Fame.
She looked up, she spotted this huge poster I had of John Wayne, Duke, on the wall, and I got up and walked toward the poster, and I guess reflexively I was walking like John Wayne. She said, "Oh yeah, that's the way he does it, except a little more like this." And she stood up and dipped her shoulder to one side and furrowed her brow and squinted her eyes and walked across the room and turned around and walked back. And I swear to God, I thought I was looking at John Wayne. She did the best imitation of John Wayne I've ever seen.